First and foremost, I too would like to begin by thanking all our hosts. So starting obviously with the most important, the Arakol people of the Bundjalung Nation. Thank you for having us in your country. Thank you, Anne, for having us here in your facility. And thank you, Ken, for putting all this together. I think it's great to be here. Now, one of the things that Ken and I and my guys talked about was that there was a range of people in the room. So what we're trying to do is make this talk, presentation, sort of fit for purpose. I was just saying that there's some things, great things that we were doing with SPAR, for example, last year, where we were talking about big deal terms and stuff, which maybe wouldn't be so relevant for everyone in this room. So forgive me if that is what you wanted to hear, because then you can save it up and use it in the Q&A. But what we're trying to make this essentially really good for the range of people that are in here. There is a Q&A at the end, which Ken and I are going to lead. Please start thinking about your questions, write them down. Really, really do use this opportunity to ask me or anyone else in the room questions. Preferably not just literally, how do I get the first act of my script working? Better if it's a higher level thing, that what's useful for your project, your career, and other people in the room can also be useful for. Just really quickly too, as Ken said, a little bit about me. Obviously I've worked all around the world in film, television, production, distribution, factual kids. For those of you who've got kids, I was responsible for Barney, I'm sorry. But at the same year that we did Trainspotting. So there's a good idea to show that there's a range of stuff that you're always going to be trying to do. As I said, I've worked in independent art house cinema. I did 6 films with Michael Winterbottom. So again, I did Jude the Obscure with him. So no one can outbleak me in art house. But at the same time, I also worked for a studio. I worked for Channel 4 Television, which is a fascinating model because it's owned by the government, but it gets not 1 cent from the government. And its entire mantra and motto is, do it first, inspire change, make trouble. So it's a really interesting thing about, it's also music to Matt's ears, it doesn't produce one thing internally, not even the news. Everything is made by independents. So it was a fascinating place to work. And then, of course, I was delighted to come back and go to work in New Zealand, where there was this tiny little thing happening where we'd been there 6 months and we managed to have Peter Jackson, Steven Spielberg and James Cameron all working at once in a town of 350,000 people. Gives you some impression. Now, I guess what I loved about that, and I was just talking to Ken, Wellington, there is no reason Northern Rivers couldn't be that. So I think with the people in this room, aim for that. Aim for collaboration, aim for community, aim for that kind of stuff. I mean, literally, Peter Jackson is the second largest employer in Wellington, which is the capital, after the government. It's massive. 12% of all tourists who go to New Zealand say Peter Jackson was the motivating factor. 12% of tourism, which is the number one industry in the country. So there is no reason why you guys can't be that, why you can't be Seattle, why you can't be that kind of stuff. So we'll come on to that a little bit later. It's an extraordinary thing which our sector does. We make content which shapes the way we see ourselves. It shapes conversations. It totally shapes the way the world sees us. And that's what you're doing. That's what you're part of. And also what we're trying to say in there is, be conscious of the incredible economic value that you are part of. We employ more full-time people than the coal and gas industry. Our exports, which by the way I think are soft, are still bigger than the sugar and honey industry exports. So it's phenomenal what people are doing, like people like Veronica are doing. You've got stuff going around the world all the time. That's extraordinary as a business, but also it is shaping the way people think about us. One of the things we found in the tourism thing, even though we're dwarfed by Peter Jackson, because we haven't had one of those yet, but someone in this room, hopefully, will be him. And I mean him actually as a producer, because he is everything. He's a multi-hyphenate. We still are more valuable in terms of tourism than the Opera House. That's pretty extraordinary. really. And again, you know, you're not going to necessarily come to Australia after seeing, you know, Ice Wars or, you know, some of those movies we have about backpackers getting killed. We do a lot of those, actually. But anyway, what I do want to also stress here is, can everybody really think about what the options and opportunities are? There are issues for everybody, and we're really aware of that. But what we're going to try and do today is go through some stuff, making sure that you understand what we do, what we don't do, what we think the challenges are for everyone, but also what the opportunities are. Now, key thing on all of this, what is Screen Australia? A lot of people aren't quite aware that we do cradle-to-grave support across everything. So we're involved in development, both of scripts and people. We do production support, we do distribution support, we do festivals, we do awards, we work with the guilds and a variety, and the industry bodies in a variety of ways. We are not a film agency, really clear. There is a lot of confusion about that. It's just one part of what we do. One of the reasons I think about that is because obviously we're involved in kids, documentaries, children's, VR, digital. Film people think about us because it's almost impossible for a film to get made without us. And I'm saying us in both ways because we also look after the producer offsets. So, but it's like less than a quarter of what we do. So don't get me wrong, if you're working in film here, I'm very keen and happy to talk to you and give you as much information because it's almost impossible for you to work in film without us. But make sure if you're not in film or even if you are in film, remember that we do a lot of things. And again, I hate to say this, I've said this a lot again with Spa's help. If you think you're going to have a career just in film, oh my God, you better have another job at Tesco's. Because it's almost impossible for you to make money and make a career just in film. Unless you are going to be Peter Jackson or George Miller. Other things that we do do, obviously, it mentions there, enterprise funding. Now, that's been an incredibly successful thing that we've done. Now, all of this stuff is on our website. And if there's another message I can give you today, you have to do research. You have to be in charge of your own career. If you are waiting for Ken or us or the school to do it for you, you almost certainly will fail. If you're just waiting for Spa to get you over the line, you almost certainly, they'll try their hardest, but you will fail. You have to do your own research and own your own career. Enterprise was boosting individuals and companies. The first one, we had a lot of success with companies that, you know, particularly in the television space, who were able to get the size and scale they needed to move into really almost sustainable businesses. The second iteration we did was about helping people primarily. Please, please, please look at our enterprise section on our websites. The goal on that was to get people where they were an advantage to themselves and the company they went into, where we were paying their salaries for up to 2 years, or contribution, $70,000 a year for their salaries. Indigenous unit, something I was very well aware of when I was overseas, and it is incredibly important to me, culturally, morally, but also commercially and creatively. It is one of the most exciting things I've ever seen. The Canadian new government, thank God, could we all just have more Justin Trudeau's everywhere? He and his new arts minister have come to us and they're going to model a, because it is unbelievable, in fact, it's scandalous. There hasn't been one in Canada with two First Nations peoples. They're just about to introduce one which is going to be modelled off ours, which is what their Minister for Arts is looking at, which is fantastic. We have a research and comms team. It has unbelievable market intel that we put up, like that promo we just did there. The Screen Currency Report, look at it. We do research things all the time. After every market or festival we go to, we try and put up a clips where we interview producers and or talent who've been to a festival or market, and they'll give you some current theories on where things are going. Talent development, obviously we do a lot of that. The producer offset. If you are going to be working in this business, it is the thing which underpins it. It dwarfs what we give out in direct funding. We're doing about $100 million a year in direct funding. On average, we're giving out, in the two offsets we look after, $250 million a year. So, and we don't do the Thors and the Pirates of the Caribbean. That's the ministry, the department itself. We look after the local television, digital and film. There's really clear 101s on the website about it. We also look after co-production treaties, we look after MOUs, we do enormous amount of stuff. How do we do it? How do we judge what we're going to do? Because all the applications that come into us, and we'll keep touching on this, during this session, the applications are doing this. Now, I find that terribly exciting. Now, I admit it's really challenging for all of you because it means you're competing with more and more and more people. So many of us, Ken, me, Matt, will get lots of you going, oh my God, it's so hard. Totally agree, totally get it. Because at the same time, our funding and the ABC's funding has been cut. But the real thing is, the applications are up. I was saying to Ken this morning, applications in our documentary area have doubled from 2011-12 to 15-16. Doubled in 3 years. And our funding's going down. So do the math. You have to be really quality, top end, scale, ambition. That's what we think of as quality. That is not meaning arty-farty. We love arty-farty. But it just means quality. So again, that gets very interesting on television. What is quality? I'm looking at Imogen Banks in front of me. She's got two shows going to be on Channel 10 at once. Well, making two at once. And it's amazing. She's here. See, there you go. She's so relaxed. They see, this is a relaxed producer. She has two shows going for Channel 10. Culturally valuable. We are a cultural agency. The reason the government invests, I hate to say this to everybody, it's actually about the stories you're telling first. It is about having businesses and an industry, because we need to have that. We don't want to get swamped just by foreign stuff. But it's the output you're making that is more important even than the individual business. I want to make that really clear again. Because what I want is, we want enough of you. There's got to be enough room of voices and businesses and thoughts. It can't all end up with one. But it's much more about the content first that you are making. It's got to be distinctively Australian. Doesn't mean it has to be Uluru or the Opera House or the surf and the beaches up here. Brilliant as that is, you make it Australian. It's your voice. It's your view of it. I'm quite clear still, to me, Hacksaw Ridge and Gatsby are Australian because of Baz and Mel and what they did with it. They took their own view on it. It has to say something about who we are, what we might become, our country, our place in the world, here and now. And innovation, key thing for us. Ken said it, it is moving so fast, this world, so fast. Television in particular and digital, and look at the knock-on effect to film. There was a great article today Don Groves had, I think, in Forbes or something, talking to a guy who's been working in the cinema exhibition business for 50 years, and him talking about this pace of change, just going, accelerating. So don't bring us stuff that you would have done in 2007 or even 2012 or probably even 2015. It's just not going to cut it. I gave a speech at AODC last week, the documentary convention, and I mentioned there's some businesses and people who've done brilliant, brilliant, brilliant work for 20 years, but they're doing the same work, the same documentary in the same form. They're operating in a tiny shrinking pool. If you're going to do that same thing, that audience that they're aiming to is getting old and going to die. You know, seriously, you have to think it through. You have to be making stuff where the audience is growing, especially on television. Why do we do it? Why does Screen Australia exist? We exist because there is market failure. If we didn't exist, the screen industry really wouldn't exist. We'd all be watching Big Bang Theory and there'd be no choice. There wouldn't be Imogen with two dramas on air on Channel 10. That's why we exist. So there's a whole lot of times people sometimes say, particularly when we've done some things recently, which I'm incredibly proud of, like Gender Matters, which great things we did up here with the Athena Project. We intervene. But guess what? Wake up. We intervene every day. All the stuff that's on air is there because primarily the government has Screen Australia, the offsets, the ABC, SBS and NITV. We are already intervening to the tune of about, well, I won't say it because it'll get back to people, but a lot of money. We intervened so there are Australian voices and Australian things on screen.